G'day, welcome to the Bronia and Bayswater Community Church of Christ. Here we seek to love God and people as Jesus did. Here we want to connect people from the crowd to the core in Christ. And we want to grow through sharing the good news of Christ with those we live, laugh and work with. We hope you find this message uplifting today. Have a great day.
Hello, my name's Elizabeth, and I'm not sure you're going to believe the story I have to tell you today. Many don't, yet it's all true, and I have my baby job to prove it. But I'm getting ahead of myself. If I'm going to tell you this story, I need to start at the beginning. My story starts when I was just a young girl. I always wanted to be a mama. I always wanted to have my own children. Whenever we'd go to friends or family, I would be the one volunteering to take care of the children. I just loved them. So when Zach and I got married, I thought, finally, it's my turn. And every month I would plan how I was going to tell him this wonderful news. And then nothing would happen. Month after month, I began to get quite disappointed. But Zach tried to console me, and he'd say things like, "Don't worry, it just takes time. Let's just enjoy practicing." I know he was just trying to make me feel better. But it didn't really help. I'd speak to other women, and they'd all say the same. "It just takes time, my dear." Well, it did take time. A lot of time. Month after month. Year after year. And still no baby. All my friends were having children around me, but my arms were empty. They'd announce that they were having their next child, and I would smile in congratulations, and I would hide my pain. I tried, look, I really did try to be happy for them and to fight my jealousy. But it was a real struggle sometimes. Over time, I noticed things change. They stopped telling me that they were expecting. You know, inevitably, eventually, I'd work it out. One of my friends managed to hide it from me for 8 months of her pregnancy. I know that they were just trying to save my feelings, protect me from being hurt, but they couldn't stop it. The pain and the sorrow of an empty womb and empty arms, it's just too much to bear sometimes. And then, after a decade of trying, I gave up. I'm sorry to say, but I did. I gave up hoping and trying. I gave up socializing with people that had children. I even gave up hiding my pain I was broken. You'd think it would take more to break a person, wouldn't you? But for me, I'd lost all hope. And without hope, what's the reason to go on? I don't know if you've ever felt that way, but for me, it was a debilitating feeling. You know, I drag myself out of bed in the morning. I go through the motions of the day. But everything just looked grey. It tasted like dust. It felt like winter. And it was as if everybody else had joy and laughter except me. I guess you'd call that depression. I don't know. I just know I've felt that way for a long, long time. Until one day, I realized I had to start living again. Otherwise, I was actually going to die. I realized that there was still beautiful things in the world to see. Delicious foods to eat. Friends that needed friendship. And joy that could be found. Yes, my life wasn't everything I wanted it to be. God had put me on this earth, and I was going to find his reason for living. So, I got dressed. I pulled my smile out from under the dusty box that I'd stuffed under the bed, and I chose to hope. I chose to pray, and I chose to believe. Not that the prayers for my own desires would be answered, but for the big picture. I believe that one day the Messiah will come and he will make this broken world whole again. And I began to see life again. I saw people I could love. I saw laughter, not as a threat, but it's a sound of joy. And I began to hope that God was doing something in the world around me. And then it happened. Like, not straight away. It probably took another 20 years or so. But you know, it felt like it went just like that. And all that living rolled from one year to the next. And eventually, life became full again and meaningful. I had nieces and nephews. I had great nieces and nephews. I had friends of all generations. And I had laughter and joy. And most of all, I had my Zach. And together we lived. And then amidst our twilight years, God dropped a huge bombshell on us. Zach was in the temple doing his duties, as he's from a Leviticus line. And as he was lighting the candles one evening, he heard a wind. And it was strange because he was in the temple, but then it changed to a whistle and then a whisper. And then he dropped the candles because there in front of him was an angel. Needless to say, he was pretty afraid. But the angel told Zach that he and I were going to have a baby. In our old age. Ridiculous, at our age. But here we are, 12 months later, and I've given birth to our baby John, just as God had promised. I can't believe it. I pinch myself again and again. My arms are full, and God has chosen us to be the parents of the prophet John. John, who will prepare the way for the Messiah. I nearly gave up. I nearly ended things early. I nearly let the bitterness made me miss all of this. But I realized that my timing is not God's timing. My ways are not God's ways. My plans are not God's plans. So I tell everybody now, don't give up on hope. Don't let the bitterness steal your hope. Don't think just because it hasn't happened yet and the way you want it to, that God hasn't got his own miracles planned for you. Whatever you're hoping for, whatever you're praying for, whatever you're searching for, keep asking, keep seeking, and keep knocking. Keep trusting and be open to God's surprises, because I'm telling you, you'd never know what he has in store for you.
So in our absence, Kay and I popped into Bayswater this morning. We missed the exciting video of Kay. She did a great job, didn't she? Did you enjoy that? A great inspiration and reminder to us that the people in scriptures are real people. Yeah, sometimes we think they're just people in a book and we forget they were real people. So thank you for embodying that with us this morning. I'm just going to read a tiny bit of Luke chapter 1. It's one of the very long chapters in the scripture. And I just want to read a tiny bit to lay a foundation of our message today. When it was time for Elizabeth's baby to be born, she gave birth to a son. And when her neighbours and relatives heard the Lord had been very merciful to her, everyone rejoiced with her. When the baby was 8 days old, they came to the circumcision ceremony. They wanted to name the baby Zachariah after his father, but Elizabeth said, "No, his name is John." "What?" they exclaimed. "There's no one in all of your family by that name." So they gestured to the baby's father what he wanted to call the baby. He motioned for a writing tablet, and to everyone's surprise, he wrote, "His name is John." Instantly, Zachariah could speak again, and he began praising God. I just want to read this last little sentence Elizabeth said. Everyone who heard about this reflected on these events and asked, "What will this child turn out to be? For the Lord's hand was surely upon him." All right, Let's pray. Loving God, as we come to your word today, as we come to Advent today, as we come with ourselves and all of our stuff, inside, outside, around about, we're reminded of your invitation. Come near to God and he will come near to you. And so we do. We intentionally draw near to you now. We become aware of your presence as we turn our eyes upon Jesus and his word and his words for us today. And we invite you to speak to us, amongst us, and breathe your life in us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, the story of Elizabeth and Zechariah is a fantastic Christmas movie plot, I think. You know, there are a lot of great Christmas movies out there, but I think Hollywood couldn't write one as good as this story, because what we know about Elizabeth and Zechariah is that this was a miracle beyond miracles. They were old, the Bible says, and I don't think they were talking about Kay's age old. They were elderly. They were elderly. And so, you know, there's this moment in time where God brings this great miracle into their lives. And I wonder if you, as you watched the little script play before, shared and understood with Elizabeth what it might have been like in the lead up to that. She didn't know for all those years that she was going to have a miracle. She lived her life with a disappointment, with the sorrow, with the heartache that the things she may have wanted to do and society expected her to do, that was never going to happen for her. And it was so wonderful to hear her tell us and draw us in and recognize our own sorrows and disappointments, because we all struggle with disappointment and sorrow and pain and grief sometimes. It's part of the world we live in, isn't it? And so we all probably understand what it's like to sit in Elizabeth's seat or stand in her sandals and feel the disappointment of not having the things we hoped for. And if we look around our world, and we appreciate your prayer this morning, Graham, as we look around our world, we're reminded it's not just us, but everybody shares in this struggle. Everybody wrestles with disappointment, with pain, with dislocation or connection. All of us carry amongst ourselves some parts of the story that are not what we thought they should be, or would be, or will be. And at this time of the year, we know it's probably even more difficult. For many people at Christmas time, it's not the most wonderful time of the year. For many people at Christmas time, it's a time that's the most difficult time of the year. The reports are that the lifeline calls increase, almost double. The need goes up over Christmas time. Information tells us that domestic violence increases over Christmas time. We understand that there is more loss of life due to self-harm over the Christmas time. And that reminds us that the struggle that we heard in Elizabeth's story is a struggle we share as human beings: disappointment, sorrow, frustration. And you and I, as we look around, we can probably say, well, yeah, we understand how people feel, and we have a sense of compassion for them. I would probably feel that way if I was in their shoes too. I would feel disappointed. I would feel angry. And we stand together with humanity, I think, when we recognize the struggles that people go through. And you know, it's important for us to do that, to acknowledge grief, to stand beside people in sorrow. We don't think people should just say the serenity prayer and everything will be okay. We know that there's a place for grief, a place to name our loss, a place to say how we feel and weep our tears. This is part of being human beings who live well. But what do we do after that? Recognition. Like, what do we do after we say the serenity prayer? What do we do once we've said, okay, well, it is what it is, and accept that? We need some more steps. We need to learn what is the pathway forward beyond just the grief the loss and the disappointment. And Elizabeth, in our story today, began to live again, didn't she? She began to say, I need to find my reason and my purpose. And I think this is a really important question for us as the people of God. We, over the next Advent season, we're unwrapping God's gifts. We're opening up the gifts that are offered to us. Today, the gift is hope. God gives us hope. And the question is, how do we unwrap God's hope in a chaotic and broken world? How do we do that? How do we help others do that? So the tension for chaos and brokenness and disappointment is that we kind of have a couple of different things that we tend to do. Okay, one of the things that we tend to do is we tend, rather than face our struggles and work our way through them, we tend to find pathways to escape them. We run from problems quite often by practices of consumption. I don't know if other people do this, but if I'm having a bad day, I think I go more often to the fridge than on a good day. Do you know what I'm talking about? Just checking what's there. Mostly it's the same things as last time. But you know, consumption. If things are difficult, I sometimes try and escape my frustrating or difficult, disappointing situation with a little bit of sugar. It helps me. I feel like it helps me temporarily. We do all sorts of consumption that numbs our pain or at least helps alleviate our stress. Sometimes it's consumption of food or drinks. Sometimes it's a consumption of shopping. Sometimes it's the consumption of work. We can work and work and work and avoid the pain. Whatever the case, many of us know how to keep going, to ignore the ache, to find something that eases the tension temporarily. But we know it doesn't solve our problem. We know that really, when the sugar is gone or the chocolate's run out, or the Tim Tams are not a packet that never ends, but that at the end of the day, the things that break our heart at the start of the day won't be alleviated by consumption. One of the other things we can do is really lean into our depression or our anger or our disappointment. And you might know people like this. Rather than trying to avoid it, they go right to it and they say all of the things they need to say over and over again about how angry and frustrated and disappointed they are. And it's not fair and I'm not rah-rah and I want and I wish and the world's not and it's... And they embed themselves in that angry posture, a posture that then leads to bitterness, that takes root in our heart and fosters things like anger and division. And, you know, we look at our globe and we can see that through the things like war. We can see it through disunity in our communities. We can see division amongst people who've embed themselves down. Rather than running from and numbing themselves from their problems, they run into their problems and they use them like a chant and a mantra. And this leaves no room for laughter or joy in their lives. And both of these kind of postures, both of these postures are running in the direction that's the opposite to God. We run from Him when we run to these postures, not to Him. And you know, Israel had their turn at that. The nation of Israel ran from God over and over and over again. And they ran to consumption over and over and over again. They flirted with idols. They filled their bellies. They loved injustice so long as it made their life better. They embraced all of the things around entertainment at the risk of drawing near to God. And they also were offended and aggressive against other nations. Their hearts were closed and the light of Israel that was meant to shine across the world was snuffed into a little wispy smoke because they ran from God, not to God. And this is the time we find Elizabeth and Zechariah. They live in Israel in a time that is under Roman occupation. And most scholars agree that God has not spoken for 400 years. The prophets are silent. The scripture's been closed. The last book of the Old Testament has been written and the ink well dried 400 years ago. And most scholars suggest that Israel believed they were living in a time when God was silent. And I suspect we sometimes feel like that too. We sometimes say, where are you, God? Where are you? I can't even hear what you're saying. Things are not going right. I don't know if you get feisty at God. I get feisty at God. I like to stomp a little bit in my head and my heart at God when things don't go right. And Israel had turned their back on God, and because they had, they couldn't hear his voice. In my house, this is a risky story. In my house, one of us is going deaf. At least one of us is going deaf. And the other one, when they try and communicate, has realized they need to make sure he's facing them so that he can hear. Right? Because when his back is turned, he can't hear my voice as well. When we run from God, in actuality, even if God is speaking, and I believe he was always speaking, but Israel couldn't hear the voice of God. They couldn't hear what he was saying because their back was turned away from God and towards the things they ran to. And my hunch is that happens to us with God sometimes too. Sometimes we turn our back on God. We don't want to talk about the things we're not happy about. And so we run from God to things that we feel might make us feel better. But in doing so, we're unable to hear his whispers. We're unable to hear his words. We're unable to detect when he's up to something because we can't see it happening. And so the invitation of this passage, firstly, is to remind us to run to God when things go wrong, not from God. I believe that's what Elizabeth and Zechariah did. I believe that they were still following God in their old age. Zechariah was still in the temple at the end of his life serving. He hadn't abandoned God. He hadn't crossed his hands and turned his back and got bitter. Instead, he faithfully continued to believe the hope that God had promised. And so he heard God speak. And he saw God act. And hope became a reality. This story is wonderful, but it doesn't help with the question though. Yeah, but what if I can't see God? What if when I'm in the dark, I can't see what he's doing? One of the challenges that we have is that we often say, God, I can't see your work, therefore you must not be working. Have you ever thought that? I can't see what God's doing. I can only see the bad things. So maybe God isn't working. Just me again? God, come on. Hello. Where are you? Can't hear you. Can't see you. I don't know what you're doing in this situation. And so sometimes, because I can't see God, I assume God's not working. And if things are going wrong, I have a further assumption, and I don't think I'm the only one. I assume also that bad things should never happen to good people, the children of God. I have this assumption that if bad things are happening, God's taken his hand off the wheel. Maybe God's forgotten. He's distracted with something else. God, where are you? That includes in my assumption. You should be here doing whatever it is I think God should be doing. But you know, this assumption is not a godly theology. It's not true to Scripture, and it's not true to God. The Scripture over and over and over again reveals that people live, the people of God, live through suffering. They live through the losses of loved ones. They go through the wilderness. They face the challenging, groaning world. And these are people inside God's covenant. So what is a better theology for us to understand? I suspect it's better for us to not say, God should always make things go right for his people. Instead to say, suffering cannot hinder the good work of God. This is the exchange theology that we see throughout Scripture instead of our assumption, what Scripture actually says. When suffering's happening, God is working. When suffering and things are going wrong is happening, God is doing his best work. When I can't see God, it's not that suffering has hindered the work of God. the powers of darkness, the brokenness of this world. Nothing can stop the good work of God. And if we adjust ourselves to understand that theology, it changes our perspective. But why would we do that? Well, because we've built our faith on the scriptures that teach us this over and again. There is Joseph, rejected by his brothers, thrown into a well, sent off, sold away in slavery, sent to prison, left in prison to die by someone who should have advocated. Over and over and over again, Joseph faces suffering. What do we see on the other side of that? Joseph says, what you intended for evil, God has used for good. Nothing, no suffering, no pain, no disappointment could hinder the work of God. Well, what about Abraham? What about Moses? Think about these people. Each of them have their story. What about David and Bathsheba? I mean, that's a suffering all of his own making. Maybe God wasn't in any of that. God wasn't working in any of that situation. Well, hang on a second. David's restoration story is one where he ran to God. And when he ran to God, eventually, it took him a little while, but when he ran to God, God welcomed him and offered him grace and restoration. And since that story, hundreds of thousands of people have sought the grace of God because of that suffering choice, that bad choice, that painful, sinful choice, which reminds us God is doing his best work despite suffering, calling it to be a servant to his work, not overcome. Suffering's not an enemy of God. Instead, God is able to subdue it to make it do his work. Does that make sense? So for Elizabeth and Zechariah, their experience was what had been lost, what was painful, God actually used. He didn't cause it, did make it happen, but he used it to bring about his glory and to reveal to them that he is the king of the jungle. Okay, finally, trusting God is the ribbon we pull to unwrap the gift of hope. To really engage in God's goodness in the midst of our suffering and sorrow, we must step into faith and trust. That's the ribbon that holds it all together. You know, we can theorize about suffering, and we do. We need to chew it over. We can have grief and loss. We can feel our pain and sorrow. But to really step beyond our suffering and pain into hope and unwrap that gift of hope, we must step through the pathway of trusting God, trusting that he is at work even when we can't see him. This is an invitation to blind faith. It's a sense that we throw ourselves completely upon God's trust, upon God and his promises, even if we don't see the results for a long time. Hebrews 11 says this, and without faith, it's impossible to please God, because he who comes to him must believe that God exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. As we pursue God with faith, we find that God is faithful. What kind of idiot would do that, though? Anyone ever said that to you? What kind of idiot would trust God? You can't see the other side. Why would you blindly trust God? And it's a good question. You know, if it was really just complete blind abandonment, but it isn't. We're stepping on thousands of years of history where God has revealed himself again and again and again to be faithful, to be good, to be kind, to be merciful, to be loving, to be miraculous. We stand on thousands of years of history, but I bet in your family history, there's a story where God has been faithful, where God has done the miraculous, where God has reached into a suffering situation and brought about joy and hope. I suspect that the experiences that formed by are not just thousands of years of someone else's story, but that our own stories have God proving how faithful he is. And if not, we must remember the incarnational experience. Why would we throw ourselves blindly upon God, trusting him even when we can't see what his work is? We would do it because God has skin in the game. He himself came to this earth, put on skin, shared our grief and suffering. The things we grieve over, the empty arms and barren wombs, the lost loved ones, the sorrows, the disappointment, the dislocation, none of these things are foreign to our God. He bore them in himself. And he invites us to trust him because he lived through it. He died because of it. And he rose again, promising to us there is life on the other side of the suffering and pain we experience. And I'm not just talking about eternal life. I'm talking about the miraculous work God is doing that we can't see right now. So, hope's not found in the bottom of a bottle. Say that three times. Hope's not found in the bottom of a bottle. No, can't do it. It's not found in a box or a bag of consumption. It's not found in the pathway of revenge and bitterness. Hope comes when we lay our hearts down before God and we trust him to do with them what he will, believing he's working for good and believing he has the power to give new life. Hope comes as we let go of striving, of pushing and fighting for ourselves, and we trust God to provide, and that is our hope. Might it be a wilderness? Yes. Might it be a challenge? Yes. Might it be a barren womb, empty arms, or a change of plans? Yes, it might be. But these hardships have never been able to hinder God in the past. They've never halted his good work before. So we can trust that he is still working, despite and even through the suffering we face. And we can trust that nothing is impossible for our God. So today I wonder, how's your hope? How's it going? Is it hot, firing on all cylinders? Or are you in need of acknowledging maybe you've been running from God and it's time to run to him, to experience his open arms, his welcome, his unshockable, unshakable love? Or maybe today you need to draw near to God in your struggles and recognize that the struggles that are happening to and around you are not an obstacle for God. And stand firm in faith that even as you face these struggles, that God is able to make them his servant for good. And finally, maybe it's time to step out onto the safety net. I'm thinking of a trapeze artist and a safety net. Looks like a bit of fun, doesn't it? Maybe it's time to trust God fully based on who he is, who he says he is, who he's proved himself to be, who he's faithfully shown you he is in the past. Maybe it's time to say some prayers that are bigger and bolder and braver than you've ever prayed before. Whatever the case, my prayer is that you might experience, as you turn to God, not from him, his whispers, his words, and his hope. And that in this Advent season, you might cheer others on to do the same, to run to God, to experience his grace, to trust him through the struggles, and to lean on him entirely, knowing that he's good for his word. Let's pray. Loving God, we thank you for your word and we thank you for this Advent season. Lord, on one hand, it's the same thing every year. And yet on the other hand, we're reminded there are new and fresh revelations for us to draw on. every time we come back to your story of incarnation. And today we've been reminded to follow in the steps of Elizabeth and Zechariah, to put our hope in you, not to run from you to all the things we think will satisfy, not to bunker down in bitterness and anger, revenge and hatred, to courageously trust that you are doing something, even in the midst of the chaos, to hold on to the hope that suffering doesn't hinder your good work, and to step out in faith, believing you are able to do all that you have promised. You always have, and you always will. So we offer ourselves to you today afresh, and we take up your gift offered to us of hope, even in the midst of this world we live. In Jesus' name, amen.